الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وأسلم على من بعث رحمة للعالمين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين وبعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. So today I want to just finish off from last week. إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين, the last part, and then we'll move on to the last portion of Surah Al-Fatiha. Hopefully we should complete by today Surah Al-Fatiha. If not, there'll only be a few things left for next week, and then we move on to Surah Al-Baqarah, insha'Allah. So last week we talked a lot about ubudiyyah, iyyaka na'budu, what it means to actually worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ibadah, what is the meaning. We went through all of that, so I won't repeat that, but the main summary of that point was that in all aspects of our lives, we submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with full humility. Remember we said, tariqun mu'abbad is the path, is the well-trodden path. And we said that ibadah comes from the word which means humility, which means to show full obedience, to show full love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, etc. So all those meanings are there in ibadah. And in every aspect of our lives, we submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with full humility, with full obedience, with full love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, and you alone we seek help from. You alone we rely on. So we said that this verse, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, is the pillar of Surah Al-Fatiha. It is the central core around which the whole Surah revolves around. And here, why is it that after ibadah, we are now asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help? Shouldn't it be you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help for the actual ibadah? What is the reason that we are saying you alone we worship, but then we're seeking the help, you alone we seek help from? Why is that coming after the ibadah? There's three points, quick points here. One is because the ibadah is the primary purpose. It is the end, it is the goal, it is the thing that we want to achieve. So that has been placed first. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ, this ubudiyyah, servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this has been placed first, because it is the goal, it is the end, the thing that we want to achieve. Secondly, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking Allah's help is also ibadah. So isti'ana is contained in the first part. Seeking Allah's help, relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is also part of ibadah. And the third reason is, it is an indication that when you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you submit fully, when you are in a state of ubudiyyah, servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning you are complying with all His commands, you are complying with all His orders, out of love and humility and obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will follow. It means the help, His assistant, His assistance, His aid will come to you anyway. If you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the aun, the help and the aid and the victory from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come. وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ, seek the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the aid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with sabr and with salah. Meaning if you do His worship, if you're in a state of ubudiyyah, servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then by necessity, His support, His help, His victory will come to you. So this is why إِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ comes afterwards. And the summary of this part of إِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ is that we do not ask anybody else for help. We do not ask anybody else for support. What does this mean? Does it mean we can't ask anybody for our daily needs? No, it means we first turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Ibn Abbas radiallahu an, that when you ask, ask Allah. Even, you know, even if it's something small, even if it's for a shoelace, even if you have some small mundane need, you might think it's nothing. But before you go and ask somebody, or before you go out to get that thing, first of all, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then seek the means. Then seek the means. So this Iyyaka nasta'in is that we seek the aid and help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and nobody else. This is the true meaning of at-tawakkul. Once a group of people from Yemen came across, Umar radiallahu anhu, he came across a group of people from Yemen. And they had the characteristic of not going out to work. Why? Because they were relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They said, we are the mutawakkilun. We are those who rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, the one who relies on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who plants the seed in the earth, meaning the one who takes action to plant the seed and the crops grow and you eat from the work of your hands. That is the one who relies on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he said, you are the people who consume. You know, in Arabic, akal and tawakkul is very similar. So he used the word. He said, you are the people who eat, meaning from the hands of others, your beggars. So this concept of tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should not mean that we do nothing and we just rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, it means both things. Tie the camel and rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Both things together. So this is the meaning of Iyyaka nasta'in. And it also shows that you and I, we cannot do our ibadah. We don't have tawfiq, we don't have the power or the strength to do any ibadah without the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore it should make us humble. It should make us full of humility. It should make us defer all the praise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, it goes back to Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. That every dhikr I do, every salah I do, every fast that I'm able to complete, every hajj or umrah that I do, it's not because of my wealth or my ability, my intellect, my piety. It's because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gave you the tawfiq. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise, all thana, all shukr, everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a story of a scholar who was in the haram. And the Khalifa of that time was also in the haram. He came either for Umrah or Hajj. And he saw the scholar who was sitting there. And he recognized him. The Khalifa recognized the scholar. And he went up to him because he was a big, well-known scholar. He said to the scholar, ask me of anything, you know, request something so I may give you. So the scholar turned around and said, I'm shy to ask in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm sitting in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm shy to ask anyone besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then the Khalifa said, okay, come outside and ask me outside. So then the scholar thought, okay, fine, I'll go outside. So the scholar said to him, whatever you're going to give me, is it something of the akhirah or something of the dunya? He said, it's something of the dunya. So the scholar said, if it's something of the dunya, the one who created the whole universe, I don't even ask him of anything of the dunya. All my du'as are to do with the akhirah. Why would I ask you? So, you know, this is a very high level of reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the thing about ubudiyyah. Last week when we talked about all those different levels and all those different states, someone might be thinking, this is too much. This is, you know, almost like fairy tales in the sense that it's unachievable today. Where am I compared to that level and that state and this quality? The thing about ubudiyyah, servitude and different levels, and we'll find out in hidayah as well, guidance, is that there is a level for every single one of us. For all of us, we are at a certain standard, at a certain degree, at a certain level. And there's always room for improvement, no matter how high you think you've achieved, or no matter how low you think you are in terms of closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in terms of our ibadah. There is a level for everybody, and there is something to aim for everybody. If I can't reach to the top, I can aim for the middle. If I can't get to the middle, I can aim for the next step above me. Meaning, as long as we are consistent, as long as we have the intention to improve ourselves, then there is something to aim for everybody. This isn't just talking about the most pious people, and it has nothing to do with us, because we're at the end of the times, and the ummah's weak, and the iman is weak. No, all of us, we have a starting point, and we can all improve, little by little. We can all aim for something, to make our ibadah that much better, that connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that much closer, that much more sincere, that much more rewarding in terms of our iman and increasing our iman, etc. Then we move on to ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. So all this time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us through Surah Al-Fatiha to first praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the first few verses of Surah Al-Fatiha is praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then we are mentioning and acknowledging that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are accountable to Him. Maliki yawmiddin. We are accountable to the King, to the owner of the yawmiddin. And then we are appealing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way with our actions. We're saying, you alone we worship, and you alone we seek help. We alone we seek help. But then now comes the dua. All of this build up is now to the crucial dua. And this is just as important as إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. It is also another pillar within the surah. And it's so important. And this is what we're asked to make dua at least 17 times a day through our salah. Surah Al-Fatiha, if we recite in all the fard prayers, it's around 17 times. Why is it we're asked to constantly make this dua? Why is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us this dua in Surah Al-Fatiha and then told us to recite Surah Al-Fatiha in every salah? So, ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim, everyone knows the translation, guide us to the straight path. Before we go to guidance, let's talk about quickly what is as-sirat al-mustaqim. What is the straight path? As-sirat comes from the same word which means to gulp or swallow something. Sirat also comes from the same word which means to gulp or swallow something easily. What's the connection between path, road, and swallowing? They said the one who travels on the path, if you look at him from a certain angle or from a distance, it's as if the road is swallowing him up or her as they travel, meaning the road encompasses that person. And the Arabs said, the Arabs don't call any path sirat. There is a special characteristic that path must have for it to be called as-sirat or siratun. What are those characteristics? It must have five things. For a path to be called sirat, it must contain or must have five characteristics. What are they? First of all, it must be mustaqim. It must be a straight path. If it's a long winding path, that cannot be sirat. It could be something else, but it cannot be sirat. Secondly, it must be sahal. It must be easy to travel on. It must be easy to travel on. Thirdly, it must be a path that many others travel on. It must be a well-trodden path, as they say in English, a well-trodden path. Maslukan. Others have traveled upon it. Fourthly, it must be wasi'an. It must be spacious, wide. It cannot be a narrow path. Not the straight and narrow. In Islam, it's the straight and wide. Right? The fifth is, it must be connected directly to the destination without any cutoff in the path. Without any blockage or without, it must be continuously connected, and it takes you to the destination. So it cannot be a path that cuts off halfway and then you're blocked. You can't go through the mountain or through something. It's blocked off. No. It's a path that has a continuous connection until it takes you to your destination. So these five characteristics of the path that we are seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us on. But obviously this is from a linguistic perspective. What is tariq? But we should reflect here that if the path, as many have said, is the deen, it's Islam. Just look at these qualities. Do we treat Islam with these qualities? Do we make Islam easy to practice? We should reflect on that. Do we make Islam spacious and wide so that it accommodates everybody who travels on it? Do we make Islam clear? Like, what is the goal of Islam? What is it we're trying to achieve? Can we see the destination? That when we talk about our deen and Islam to other people, is it clear what we're talking about? Is there a straight path that we're showing people? So these are things that we can reflect on when we talk about as-sirat. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the alif lam. Ihdina as-sirat. Alif lam is there. As-sirat al-mustaqim. Why is the alif lam there? As people who study basic Arabic, you know the al is there for ta'rif, to make it definite. Right, is defined. But there's different types of al. What they said here is that no, this path is a well-defined path. It's not any path. It is a well-defined path known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, known to those who traveled on this path. We're not asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just guide us on any path. No, we're asking guidance on a very specific, a very particular path. It's a defined path. It's the path that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has laid down. It's the path that His blessed people have traveled on. It's the path that leads to His pleasure. It's the path that leads to Jannah. It's the path that leads you to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's a very particular, specific path. And there's two things that come out of this. One is, we can't say then all the rivers lead to the ocean, right? Have you heard of that expression? All the rivers lead to the ocean. Doesn't matter what you worship, you know, doesn't matter what you believe. Ultimately, all religions lead to the same thing. All the rivers lead to the ocean. No, there is a specific path here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, as-sirat al-mustaqim. It has to be the path. The straight path. It's defined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's the path that, and it's not just the path of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because as we'll see, it's the path of the Nabiyeen. It's the path of all of the prophets alayhim as-salam. It's the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is valid in every age, in every time. The revelatory laws and guidance that were sent to every community at all times, and they were all called Islam. They were all called by the title of Islam. Islam is not, with the capital I, just the religion of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is the religion, it is the path, it is the way of all of the prophets who came with the true guidance. So we say, yes, it's a defined path. Not all the rivers lead to the ocean. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a specific path. If you want guidance, you have to travel on this path. Number two, for those of us within the deen, within Islam, we can't simply make up our own way. Can't make up your own tariqah. You can't make up our own way that I'll practice the deen this way. I'll set up a certain set of rituals. This will lead me to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, there is a defined path that the Nabiyeen have traversed on, that the Shuhada, the Siddiqeen, the Shuhada, the Salihin, the truthful ones, the martyrs, the righteous ones, the prophets, they have all traveled on this path to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a clearly defined path. It's the path that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. So we can't make up our own way of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we all know for worship to be accepted is two things, ikhlas, sincerity, and it has to be in accordance to what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. So in terms of, so that's the path. And most people said, it's many things. Some people said this Sirat al-Mustaqim is the Quran. Some people said Sirat al-Mustaqim is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba. Some people said Sirat al-Mustaqim is the whole deen, it's Islam. Others said it's Sharia, obedience to the Sharia. So many, many people said many things, more or less the same thing. It is the deen. And Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyah, he says it very nicely. He said, this Sirat is that path that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has laid down. And it is that path that only those He has blessed are able to travel on that path. And it is that path that all other paths to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are closed. All other paths, he said, are masdood. They're blocked. There is no other way of reaching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except through this path. It is the only path that leads to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the Sirat al-Mustaqim. So then we come to guidance. So we're asking guidance, guide us to this Sirat al-Mustaqim. What does guidance mean? What does hidayah mean? In the Quran, there's four types of hidayah. There are four types of hidayah mentioned in the Quran. The first type is very general. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah Taha, he says, الَّذِي أَعْطَى كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلْقَهُ ثُمَّ هَدَى. The one who gave everything its creation or its shape, and then he guided it. This is one type of guidance. ثُمَّ هَدَى. This is one type of guidance, meaning that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates something, He guides it to do the thing that it was created for. Whether it's the trees, or the animals, or the fish in the sea, or human beings, or anything else, or the planets. He's created it, and then He's guided it to do what it's supposed to do. This is a generic guidance, hidayah. It's called hidayah as well. The second type of guidance, hidayatul bayan wad dalala. The second type of guidance is a guidance of explanation and pointing towards, explaining something, showing something. That is a type of guidance where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَمَّا ثَمُودُ فَهَدَيْنَاهُمْ فَاسْتَحَبُّوا الْعَمَى عَلَى الْهُدَى فَاسْتَحَبُّوا الْعَمَى عَلَى الْهُدَى. So as for the Thamud, we guided them, but they preferred blindness over guidance. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the word فَهَدَيْنَاهُمْ. He guided them. If He guided them, how can they choose blindness over guidance? No, here guidance means He simply explained the right and wrong. He simply showed them this is right, this is wrong. He told them which way to go for the haqq and this is the batil. But they chose to go towards the batil, to oppose the haqq. So this second type of guidance is simply to show somebody, to teach somebody. The third type of guidance is hidayatul tawfiq wal ilham. The guidance of tawfiq and ilham, where you're inspired and you're given tawfiq, ability by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be guided. This is the third type. This is the actual real guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This third type, no one can give. No matter how much you invite others, you may invite non-Muslims or other members of your family or relatives, that thing you're doing, that guidance you're giving is number two. The guidance of bayan, irshad, dalala. The guidance of teaching, explaining, showing. You are showing them the path. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in one instance that you guide to the straight path. And then in another verse, the Prophet, Allah said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you cannot guide whom you love. So some people said, this sounds contradictory. One instance, Allah is saying that you guide to the straight path. And then he's saying, you cannot guide whom you love. But there is two different types of guidance. The first one is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he guides the number two guidance, which is explanation and teaching. He does that to the straight path. But number three, the guidance of tawfiq, of ilham, the true guidance to accept Islam, even the Prophet Muhammad has no power to do that. Even the prophets, they have no power to do that. It is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who can guide with this tawfiq of iman, accepting Islam. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can guide in that level. And the fourth type is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses in the Quran, in the meaning of leading someone to either the Jannah or the hellfire. He uses the word hidayah, meaning the angels lead them from the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to either Jannah or to the hellfire. So four types of hidayah are mentioned in the Quran. What we ask for in this surah, ihdina sirat al-mustaqim, is the guidance of number two and three. The guidance of bayan, of explanation, of making clear what the straight path is, of teaching us what the straight path is, and number three, the guidance of tawfiq, of ilham, to inspire us and give us tawfiq to be on the right path. So this is the guidance we are asking for. Then there are 10 levels of guidance. And if you complete all 10, then guidance is perfected. And this will explain, because someone can ask, if we're already Muslims, why do we need to constantly ask for guidance? If we're already Muslim, and obviously in Surah Fatiha, if you're praying, you're also doing your salah. And you're reciting the Surah Al-Fatiha, you're reading the Quran. If I'm already guided as a Muslim, I'm a believer, and I'm doing salah, and I'm reciting this Surah, why do I still have to recite this every few hours, all of my life? What is the wisdom behind that? Well, the wisdom is because guidance has many, many levels. And we need all types of guidance. There are many types of guidance. There's many details of guidance, of hidayah. And there's many levels of guidance. And we need all of it. You cannot be completely guided unless you have all of it. So the first level is hidayatul ilm wal bayan. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the guidance of knowledge and clarity, right? To make us aliman bil haqq mudrikan lahu, so that we know and recognize the truth when we see it. We know and recognize the truth when we see it. The second level is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the power and ability to actually recognize and see the truth, or to actually follow it. Because somebody can see the truth. There are many Muslims, born Muslims, in their hearts, they know the truth. They know there is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists, there is a day of judgment, there is Quran, we believe it's the word of Allah, but yet, I can't be bothered to practice the deen at the moment in this stage of my life. Does this person know the truth? Yes. Is he guided to follow the truth? No. He still hasn't got that part of guidance to actually practice the deen. So that's the second. Third, أَيَّجْعَلَهُ مُرِيدًا لَهُ. The third level of guidance that we ask in this dua is to make us desirous of wanting this guidance. Someone can know the guidance is there. Like I mentioned, there's many, many Muslims, born Muslims. They know the guidance is there, but they don't want it. For whatever reason, they don't want it. They're not muridan lahu. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put that desire in us, to want and need guidance. Then the fourth level of guidance is to make us implement, to act upon the guidance. Someone can know it, someone can want it, but someone could have the ability to act on it, but they're not acting on it. Someone can know salah is fard. They're healthy. They've got the power, ability to pray. They know it's a fard. They know there's punishment if they don't pray. But they don't implement it. They don't pray. This is the fourth type. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after giving us knowledge about salah or about any truth of the deen, that He gives us the ability to implement it, to know it, to want it, and to implement it. This is the fourth level of guidance. And then the fifth level is somebody could pray salah. Someone can practice the deen one day and leave it the other day. Someone may not be consistent. Someone may dip in and out of the deen. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what? For thabat, for consistency, to establish us on the deen, to make us consistent on the deen, so that we practice the deen every day. We're on guidance every day, not in and out. But someone may be consistent for a while, and there may become an obstacle, a big disaster in his or her life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that. And this may shake their faith. This may shake their faith. So this may prevent them, or something else may come in their life, something else may happen that prevents them from being consistent and to being steadfast on the deen. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from all those obstacles that stop us from being steadfast on the deen. Number seven, that once He's guided us on the path, within the path, there are many, many ways to be guided. Many levels, many ways to be guided. There are details in the guidance itself. It's not just accept Islam and that's it. There's decisions that you and I make every single day. Are we guided in those decisions? Every choice we make, is it the best for my dunya and akhirah? Is it earning the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So there's details, so we ask for the detailed guidance. Number eight, we ask for the guidance to see our destination. Where are we traveling towards? If you travel along a path and you can't see the end, you can't see your destination, isn't that journey very difficult? You don't know when you're arriving. And sometimes you may lose focus because you can't see. Or you think it's so far away, I'll take a break, I stop on the side, I get busy doing something else. But if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows you the destination, keeps that in front of you all the time, you will not lose focus, you will not be diverted. You will be focused, you will be steadfast, you will be ever moving towards your goal. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to see the destination, which is Jannah, or which is closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or which is the Akhirah, that we keep this in front of us all the time. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us for that too. And number nine, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the understanding and the acknowledgement that we are so in need of this guidance above everything else, that there's nothing in this world that we need more than this guidance. Nothing material in this world that we could possess, no wealth, no fame, nothing that is more important, that there is a more of a need for us to possess than this guidance, this hidayah. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts this in our heart, and it's established firmly in our heart, then we can prioritize the akhirah over the dunya. We can prioritize the halal over the haram. We can prioritize that thing that will make us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compared to that thing which will drive us away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to make us realize our absolute poverty, our faqr, our need for this guidance above everything else in this life. So this is a level of guidance that we also seek. And the last one is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us the two paths that divert from this path. From As-Sirat al-Mustaqim, there are two paths that divert off, that will take you away from the path. One is the path of those who have earned the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who have earned the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The other one are those who have gone astray. So that is also a guidance. We need to be guided to see that, to recognize that. Both these diversionary paths, and to see it in contrast to the straight path. So we need to have the vision, the ability, the insight to see the straight path, but also to recognize which path is diverting us off and going towards those upon whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's wrath is upon, and those who are misguided, so that we can see all three paths very clearly. We're not deceived. We don't make the mistake of going off into the other paths, leaving the Sirat al-Mustaqim and going off into the other paths. So these are the 10 levels of guidance, if you like, that complete hidayah. And you can see why we need to ask for guidance every single day. If you look at the detail, if you look at the levels, if you look at the need we have to make the right decision every minute, every hour of the day, with regards to so many different things, with regards to our deen, with regards to practicing the deen, with regards to choices we make in our daily lives, worldly choices that we may think, this is nothing to do with my deen, or this will not affect my deen. But it has, it's related, it will impact you. So every choice we make, every step we take, we need guidance. We need it. We need to be guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that it is a step that will benefit us in the dunya and akhirah. It is a step that brings us closer to our destination. It's not a step that takes us away. That's why we have to say, Ihdina sirat al-mustaqim, every day, every time in our salah, in every rak'ah of our salah. Then there are two quick points about our attitude towards this guidance. There's two quick points that we need to bear in mind. That every decision or every action before you do it, the attitude should be, is this from the Sirat al-Mustaqim? Is this action part of this guidance? If it is, then I should desire it. I should make a determined effort to do it. I should make a determined effort to be guided to do it and implement it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If this action is opposite, it's something sinful, harmful, or there's a doubt in it, or it may take me away from the guidance, then I should have the full conviction and determination to stay away from it. This is the two attitudes and decisions that we need to make on a daily basis, on an hourly basis, on whatever actions we're doing. In that way, we'll be conscious of traveling on this path. In that way, we'll be conscious of being on the Sirat al-Mustaqim. There's no use every day saying, Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim, if every day we're not thinking about whether we are journeying on this path. And look at the beauty of the imagery that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates here. That you are journeying on this path. Life is a journey. There is an end destination. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also said this. Be in the dunya as though you are a stranger or a traveler traveling across a path. And he's also said that the likeness of me is the one who is traveling and then sits under the shade of the tree to take rest for a few moments and then gets up and goes. Meaning that shade of the tree is the dunya. You're only here temporarily. We must be aware that we are on this journey. And Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, he has a sharh of a book which explains all of the steps or degrees, if you like, all of the states between إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, 600 pages, 3 volumes, all of the different aspects of reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of being in worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of having sincerity, of making tawbah, of our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of this is explained just from this إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. So this is why the guidance, hidayah, is the greater, and subhanAllah, coincidentally, the word gift in Arabic also comes from the same word. It is the greatest gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to mankind, to be guided. Think of so many people who are not born with the deen. Look at the hardship people make to discover this deen. Look at the hardship people make when they convert to this deen. They face so many obstacles from their friends, from their family, from their livelihoods. So many obstacles are there, so much sacrifice people make to come to this guidance. And yet many of us were given it on a plate, were born as Muslims, and yet we don't value it. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us the real value of this guidance. So we should understand it properly, we should value it properly. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ, the path of those that you have blessed. The path of those that you have blessed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say the path of the prophets. He didn't say the path of the shuhada here, or the path of the salihin. He simply left it as the path of those whom you have blessed. He's left it mubham. He's left it kind of unidentified. Why? Two reasons. One is that those whom he has blessed are many. Who has he blessed on this path? In one part of the Quran, it mentions four categories of people. The Nabiyeen, Siddiqeen, Shuhada, and the Salihin. The four categories of people, the prophets, the martyrs, the truthful ones, the martyrs, and the salihin, the righteous. But are they all the same category? Within those categories, there's many, many different types of people. There's many, many people on different types of levels. There's many, many different levels of favors that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted to each and every one of them. There may be one person who's a salih, but he's received a certain amount of favors from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another salih, he's on a higher level. He's on a much higher level. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has favored him and blessed him even more. Same with the prophets, alayhim as-salam. They're not all on the same level. Same with the martyrs. They're not all on the same level. And with every category, there are differences within the people in terms of how much favor they have received from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had said the path, and he identified the path and connected it with any one of these categories, then the favors would have been restricted to just that category. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has left it open, meaning we're saying that guide us to that path, the path on which you have favored those people, meaning the favor that you've given at all levels of all types of favors. No matter how great or small it is, we're in need of each of those favors. We're in need of the guidance that was received by every single person within those categories. So it's aam. It encompasses every need that I have. It encompasses every level that we're at. Every level of need that we have of guidance is included in this. By leaving it as mubham, as rather than mentioning the people, it just says, of those whom you have favored. So this is an immense blessing in the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has expressed that. And here he said, we say that you have blessed. We don't say those who have been blessed. It says the ones that you have blessed. The blessing is connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whereas those whom your anger is upon, or those who have earned your anger, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not mentioned there. Those who have gone astray, it just said dalin and maghdubu alayhim. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not mentioned. But where it comes to favors, it's mentioned directly that you have favored them. The path of those whom you have favored. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us adab. We connect the good things, the favors, the ni'mah, the bounties, the blessings to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not because they are prophets that they were favored. It's not because they were martyrs that they were favored. It's not because they were siddiq that they were favored. It's not because of this or that or salih. It's direct favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's connected, the cause of the favor is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. So we must always remember that. And the wrath that those people have earned, those who went the wrong way, and the misguidance, these are connected to the people themselves. Although Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in charge of everything, but see the adab, anything bad, anything evil, is connected to the people. Anything good is connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think that's all we have time for today. Just to wrap up this, we've more or less finished. Next week, inshallah, we'll start Surah Al-Baqarah. We'll finish off the last part of Surah Al-Fatiha. But this is just to summarize, each and every one of us, we are on a journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just reflect and take a few moments. You know, on a journey, there's people that are way ahead of us. There's people that are hundreds of miles ahead of us. There are people that are thousands of miles ahead of us. There are people that are behind us. There are people that are catching up. On a journey, if you stop and rest and start being diverted and watch the scenery and enjoy the stopover, then you fall behind on the journey. Simple as that. And this is the likeness of the dunya. If in our ibadah, in our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in our implementation and rushing to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are slow or we're taking too much rest, then we'll be behind on this journey. Abdullah ibn Mubarak, once he had a meal, a very nice meal, and after he finished, he straight away jumped up. And he said, once the donkey is fed, he must get back to work. You know, these people, they saw the food, and these are means, fuel for the journey. Straight away, as soon as they've had something nice, they remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That they're here for a purpose. They're here to work. They're here to travel. They're here on a journey. Not to stop and build houses and build gardens. Yes, all that is halal and it's fine. But don't let that divert you. Don't let that slow you down on your journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't let that weigh you down and cling to the earth. So we're all on this journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And each and every one of us are at different stages. And we should try and catch up with those who went before us. One of the Sahaba said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a people have gone way ahead on a journey. A caravan has left and there's no hope of catching up with them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam understood what he meant. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and the Sahaba, he was saying, how can I ever catch up with them? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, al-mar'u ma'a man ahab. The person is with the one whom he loves. The person is with the one whom he loves. Meaning, you may be behind on this journey, but if you truly love those who are ahead of you, you will be with them on the Day of Judgment. You will be with them in Jannah. If it's a true love, a true love that forces you to act, not a love which is just in the heart and yes, I love the Prophet ﷺ, I love the Sahaba, but I don't do anything to obey the Prophet ﷺ and I don't make any effort. But the Sahaba said that nothing after accepting the deen on the Day of Judgment, accepting the deen when the Prophet ﷺ came to them, nothing made them more happy than this saying of the Prophet ﷺ. Because they knew, they all loved the Prophet ﷺ more than any other creation. They all knew that in their hearts they had the love, they knew they loved the Prophet ﷺ more than anything. More than anything. The Sahaba who was asked, who was being tortured and punished, and said, would you, if we let you go in your place, you know, would you put Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, bring him in your place and we'll let you go? He said, wallahi, I would not want the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be hurt by a thorn on his foot and me to be saved from this punishment. And the woman who lost her husband, her brothers, her sons in the battle, and she received this news that she's lost all these people, all her relatives, her son, husband, brothers, at least 4 or 5 people from her male relatives. And when the Sahaba, they were coming back from the battle, her first question was, what is the situation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Her first question wasn't, what happened to my husband, my son, my brothers? No, the first question was, what is the situation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What is his condition? Is he safe? This is the love they had for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If we have this love for those who have journeyed ahead of us, then there is hope, there is a little hope, if we make the effort and cultivate this love in our hearts and let it manifest in our actions, that there is some hope of trying to catch up where the forerunners have gone. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us in guidance, in hidayah, in knowledge, in understanding the truth and recognizing it, in all aspects of hidayah that's required to actually be on the path, to be on the straight path, and to be journeying forward, not to be stopping and going backwards. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for all of us.